we want to introduce to you one of the city's successful programs, a program that helps those who have fallen prey to addiction, but it helps them get back on their feet. It was featured during the one-year anniversary of the Champion Plan earlier this month.
Champion Plan, right off the bat, to me, it means I think of a new life.
This isn't just a one encounter. They get you somewhere and then you're done with them. They stick with you.
What the Champion Plan really is, it's police-assisted recovery. The idea is that anyone who's struggling with any form of addiction can walk into the police department and ask for help.
Well, the process is very effective. When the person has their moment of clarity, they come into the station, which is a big step. That's a big first step. When they come into the lobby, they're identified, they're put into our computer, and then we have to run a warrant check. If they have a warrant, we have to arrest them, we bring them to court, and we've had 100%, as of today, that come back to join the Champion program after they clear their warrant.
Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna run your name, okay? Make sure everything is clear, make sure there aren't any warrants, okay? Once that clears, I'll put in a call, and we will give them a call. They'll come pick you up within 15 minutes or so, okay? Also, I need to let you know we have to pack for a skew just for their safety, okay? All right, so have a seat for a minute, okay?
If they're okay with warrants, then we do a Corey check on them. If they clear the Corey with the parameters we have on that, then they're accepted into the Champion Plan. We call over to our partners, and a champion will come over, one or two, and they escort them to the program.
Hi, it's Officer Brown, and I have one female to be picked up, okay? All right, thank you.
And then we partner with the Gandara Center to take it from there and help individuals with placement of what they're interested in, whether it be detox, outpatient, CSS placement, provide transportation through Brewster and follow up with them with recovery coaches.
They will call us to transport someone to a facility for detox, medical detox, or wherever it may be. It makes us feel great to be able to help out because it is a barrier for some people. They're unable to get these rides that they need because they may be going to Springfield. Sometimes they even go to Rhode Island. There's a facility in Rhode Island that we go to also. So it makes us feel great to be able to help out.
Hi, I'm Anne. I'm from the Champion Program. I understand you have someone for us.
Yes, hi, Anne. Okay, she's right over here.
Okay.
All right, she's all set. I just have her ID.
Okay, ID.
What we've done is not just put a person in a detox, we've put a person into a pipeline of treatment, a continuum of treatment with constant follow-up by a recovery coach who's going to be always assisting and motivating this person to continue on to the next level of treatment.
I got your back. I'm here for you. I can support you in this. To see the active involvement of law enforcement within the community saying, we're not gonna arrest you. We're not gonna throw you in a cell or put cuffs on you. We're invested in you getting better because if you get better, it's going to reduce crime and complications within our city. And we have an interest in you as a human being. I think that you can't replace those things.
Because we know that we've had a merry-go-round going on with detoxes for years, and that what we need to do is we need to help people make that decision to remain in treatment longer. And the longer we can keep them in treatment, then the odds go up significantly as they're in terms of them being able to stay sober when they leave.
I think the most wonderful thing about the program is the number of people that they've been able to help in such a short amount of time. In just 10 months in 2016, they served almost 300 people, and many of those people multiple times. And I think one of the things that they're proudest of, and I think is a huge success for them, is that 13% of those people, this was the first time that they had access treatment services. So this is the first time they tried to get help, and they came to the Champion Plan for that help.
We would argue that the Champion Plan is really at the cutting edge of policing. The Brockton Police Department is in a true partnership with the treatment community. Police traditionally address issues of the drug problem by attempting to arrest their way out of a problem. We know with pretty well documented evidence that there's limits to the arrest response.
Most of the clients that they receive or treat, 87% of them are going into a detox program and they're transported right to that program. The Champion Plan, the wait time between a client entering the program and finding, and the Champion Plan staff finding a treatment bed for them is less than 2 hours.
So it is really about spending a little bit of money on the front end of a problem in order to prevent the further escalation of a problem.
They worked with my counselors in treatment facilities. They worked with me when I left the treatment facility. And unfortunately, there was a time where I slipped. And you know what? They didn't give up. They didn't down me for it. They just said, that's okay. It's a part of recovery. You know, come back.
The Champions Plan, to me, is a lifesaver. I can't even describe how grateful I am for the Champions Plan. It 100% saved my life. A lot of people, you know, say that, throw that around, but I am 100% positive that I wouldn't be here without the Champions Plan.
You cannot, I don't care what anybody says, you cannot do this by yourself. You need help. You have to have other people to help you. And that's what the Champion Program does. They are there in, you could call them at any time of the day and they will help you.
A little embarrassed, you know, on my end, but I mean, all around it was, you know, they were very nice and helpful. I wasn't there too long, probably an hour. My brother and my stepfather were there. And then they came down, picked me up, and it was a smooth process.
I usually tell people, you know, if you're still alive, you still have a chance. And this is an amazing place that is available to help people when they're ready to make that decision, to get them help that they desperately need in a timely fashion. And sometimes that's hard for us to do on our own.
I have a 7-month-old daughter, and she's a happy baby because I'm happy. And you know, I like to give a lot of gratitude to the Brockton Police and the Champion Plan because my dream was to be a mother and go to school and get my life together, and it's done that for me.
So the most important thing that I like to share with the participants is that the mayor and Gandara Center have created a safe place for them to come and get supports for their recovery. This is their space always. Whenever we're open, they can stop by for resources or support, or even just to speak with somebody, but we'll always be there for them.
Come through the door. Everybody's friendly. From the officers to the champion that's gonna walk you back to the program once you're in it, and the 18 months of phone calls that you're gonna receive afterwards. They're gonna support you all the way through.
This program was designed to help you, to help people. And you have to take that first step in order for it to happen. So I would say please.
It's never too late. Walk in today.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. Now, we have good government only when we play an active part in making it good. Let's say our pledge with that in mind tonight. Here to help us do that is World War II veteran and longtime Brockton friend and entertainer, Mr. George Cataldo. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you so much. The next person I want to introduce is very special to me. One, she happens to be my sister, and I'm very proud of her and I love her, but she's also very talented. She's the person who will kick the program off in song tonight. She's also the same woman who wowed all of New England after winning the very first Boston Pops Talent Search Contest. More than 3,000 people applied, 700 auditioned. It was a proud moment for a lot of us here because this Brockton native and Brockton school bus driver sang her heart out that night on the 4th of July with the Boston Pops at the Hat Shell. But this time, we're going to ask her to do it again with a rendition of God Bless America. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm welcome to Tracy Silva.
Bless
You can continue. No, I'm kidding. Thank you, Tracy, so much. Thank you, appreciate that. Delivering tonight's invocation is a man known to many of us in the city. He chairs the Diversity Commission, is an executive member of the Brockton NAACP, and sits on the Southeastern Regional School Committee. Please give a warm welcome to Bishop Tony Branch.
I warned the mayor that having me do the invocation is something different because I'm a Pentecostal preacher. Amen?
Amen.
The purpose of an invocation, as you all know, is to summon the presence of God. God commands us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. To love is to believe. So the real question for Brocktonians today and those that are visiting from other parts of the Commonwealth, are we loving each other as neighbors? Can you stand on your feet for one moment? So this has to be an invocation, amen, where we invoke God collectively, not simply the bishop, not simply a pastor or a preacher, but you in your own spirit. So if you believe in that, participate in this invocation by looking to your neighbor on the right side and say these words, I believe in Brockton.
I believe in Brockton.
We are in the war memorial.
We are in the war memorial.
So you must say it again, I believe in Brockton.
I believe in Brockton, I believe in Brockton.
Because I believe in you.
Believe in
now, if you believe that, give yourself a hand clap. Neighborly love is what's going to allow us to live successfully in our city. Bow your heads with closed eyes. Almighty God, Lord of the universe, you have given us the spirit to do good things in our city for our neighbors. We rejoice in your authority. God, you gave us a leader in Mayor Bill Carpenter. May your spirit anoint him afresh and cover him in all of his work so that he may be strong and encouraged in all that he does in leading our city. Almighty God, cover with thy spirit the city council, the school committee, the state delegations, and citizen commission, so that they may know it is by your portion that they should bring good decisions based upon equality, justice, and economic prosperity for all in our city. Almighty God, help us to remember how fortunate we are to have America as our liberty, the beauty and wealth of the Commonwealth, and the fact that we all are citizens, affirming today that we believe in each other. Lord, help us to never rely on rhetoric, but on every truth birthed from your portion, beholding that Brockton's diversity of neighbors cements Brockton strong as champions. Almighty God, touch the sick, the homeless with your spirit, while protecting our police, our firefighters, and collectively all our first responders. Lord, cover them with your strength of heavenly angels. God, we thank you for hearing us on this day. In the name of the Christ that I pray with, may those that believe, those that are people in this place, please say, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Bishop. Folks, at this time, we'd like to play a special video for you, which was aired on Brockton Cable as a tribute to a dear friend, Police Chief Robert Hayden, who passed away just 1 month ago. For a chief who served just a short time with us, he left quite a legacy.
If I were a law-abiding, decent person in the city of Brockton, Bobby Hayden would be the guy that I'd want to have his police commission.
When our administration came in January, the chief and I shared the view that, you know, Brockton was at a critical time in its history in terms of public safety. And that was, we had to make a decision as to whether we were going to passively allow criminals and drug dealers and gang members to take over control of the city, or we were going to fight back and reclaim streets and blocks and neighborhoods for the good people that live here. And so the chief chooses to fight back. I choose to support him doing that.
On the other hand, if I were a criminal and who wanted to disrupt people's lives and to deny them their freedoms and their liberties, Bob, you couldn't have a more serious adversity than Bobby Hayden. He's a person who is determined. Bobby Hayden is not a show horse, he's a workhorse. He's somebody that when you need something done.
And I hope that this will be a clear message is being sent that if you sell drugs in the streets of our city, we will arrest you and put you away. So if you want to sell drugs, go find someplace else. We're not going to tolerate it here.
A couple of months ago, we came up with a list of the 50 worst criminals in Brockton. And today, two of the top five are no longer wandering the streets of Brockton. They're safely ensconced with us downstairs in a cell block.
Motorcycle officers also carry the chief's vision of true community policing, of getting all police officers to interact with the community. The motorcycle officers are very approachable. People approach them constantly and interact with them in a way that they would have never had the opportunity if that same officer was sitting in a police cruiser with the window rolled up and the AC on. So the motorcycle patrols have had a great impact. And then the most recent thing, if you've been down Legion Parkway, is he put up this tower. He came to me about a month ago and said, I've got a relationship with the transit police and they're willing to lend me this surveillance tower. And it goes about 40 feet up in the air and it's got cameras on it. And I said, Chief, go for it if you think it'll make a difference.
Mayor Carpenter and I got along great because the minute I met him, I knew that he had that type of a personality, and I probably wouldn't have stayed here after what happened to me if I didn't have him to come back to. So I want to also give him a round. He has said he and I are so much alike. They were like Batman and Robin. And I asked him before I leave to tell me who's Robin. Thank you. Cities and communities are made for good people, dads, moms, people that like to use playgrounds, people that like to take their little boy or girl out and hit a baseball to or throw a frisbee. We're not going to let people that aren't champions, that don't like people like us, destroy our way of life. And just thank you very much for listening to me and appreciate the opportunity. I treasure the time that I'm here. And I'm just honored that I was able to be here for a while and see these guys at work. We're here to try to find the person that did this to this beautiful lady. And thank you for all your help. Thank you. Every time I pass a person on the street that was in worse shape than most of us are, I give them $5 or $10. I was sitting down on a wall talking to some of the homeless people down at Perkins Park a couple of days ago, and I really loved them. And I you know, shook hands with them, I hugged them, told them that we care about as much about you as, you know, rich white people. I think that's about it. Let me ask my wife.
That's all for now.
Thank you.
The mission is clear. This is our city, and we will continue to fight for it. Before the end of the month, Chief Hayden will be stepping down and completing his year of service to the city of Brockton. When we said 1 year, we meant 1 year. And it's funny, working with Chief Hayden for the past year, I've never really been exactly sure who was working for who. But the first year of my career as mayor is the last year of the chief's career as a law enforcement officer, and I'll never forget it. Chief, I love you, and thank you for everything that you have done for the people of Brockton.
I got to meet Chief Hayden only a few brief times, and he definitely left a lasting legacy on all of us. Before we get to the mayor, I'd like to introduce our next guest, who will share a few remarks. She will probably be the first to tell you that we still have a lot of work left to do here in Massachusetts. She should know, because she crisscrosses the state all the time, often visiting us here in Brockton a lot as well. But last month, U.S. News and World Report ranked Massachusetts the best state in the nation overall. Let's give a warm welcome to Lieutenant Governor Karen Polito.
Thank you very much. Oh, yeah, you got it. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here in this room, in this beautiful War Memorial building. I want to thank each and every one of you for being in this room tonight. When I received the invitation from the mayor, I quickly said to my scheduler, I said, we've got to be there. This is a place I absolutely will be honored to be a room to be in and to be a part of the history here that you're making in this great city of champions. As the bishop said, I believe in this city, and I know that every one of you do too. I have spent a bit of time here, and I have a great fondness for all of you. I want to thank you, and that's why I am really here tonight. As we are a state that is known for being a state of first, and I love the new title that we have, being the number one state in the country. We are a number one state, not because of what happens on Beacon Hill, but because of what's happening in the cities and towns across our Commonwealth. And when we strengthen the cities and towns of this great state, we will truly strengthen this Commonwealth and continue to be that number one state. But this all happens because of the people who represent this city. I want to thank the state delegation who is here. I had the honor of serving with you when I was in the House of Representatives. I want to thank the City Council. I was a former local official as a selectman in my hometown. I thank you for the work that you do. I want to thank the business community for always believing in this city and investing and being a part of the history of this great city. I want to thank the people in uniform. The motorcycle Kate is here. To all the police officers, firefighters, those that wear the uniform every single day to protect and serve this city, and to the people of this great city, those who are born and raised here and still here, raising your own families, with your deep roots in this community and those who are moving here as new immigrants, coming to school here to be part of the Massachusetts experience and the Brockton experience, thank you. Because you're demonstrating with your own actions that you truly believe in this city. I want to personally thank Mayor Carpenter. 2 years ago, when the governor and I came into office, we called upon the mayor to help us. One area that I am focused on particularly is building a stronger relationship between state government and our cities and towns. And I called upon the mayor to be part of a group of managers and mayors to advise our administration about how to do that. And with many hours of time he put into it, we were able to develop a best practices community compact program. And to date, we have 269 cities and towns signed into the compact program, and Brockton was one of the first. I also want to thank the mayor on behalf of Governor Charlie Baker, because he called upon the mayor to be part of the opiate addiction task force that we formed soon after taking office. And the mayor helped guide us and helped us make decisions and our state delegation with passing legislation and making policies that will improve the quality of life for those individuals who are addicted and prevent so many others from becoming addicted because of prescription medications and the exposure to opiates. Your mayor is truly a champion for all of those in this community and for many across our Commonwealth. We are grateful for his leadership in this area and others. And finally, tonight is your night to take a pause and to reflect on the great successes that this community is experiencing. And together come into this room and leave with the purpose of continuing the good work that you're doing, continuing to make this a great city for everyone who comes here to call this home. God bless you all. It's an honor and a pleasure to be with you.
Well, folks, as many of you know, by looking at your invitation, Boston Mayor Marty Walsh was supposed to be here. But a conflict came up and he couldn't make it, and he sends his sincere apologies for not participating in the State of the City address with us. Congressman Stephen Lynch was going to pinch hit for him, but House Speaker Paul Ryan had different ideas for him because they were supposed to vote on the health care bill, which I understand from Councilor Barnes, that vote didn't happen either. So he's coming back from Washington now as we speak. But we want to thank our next guest for being gracious enough to introduce our mayor at the State of the City. He was the mayor of Boston and later became the ambassador to the Vatican. Ray Flynn has been here before, and we're honored to have Ray Flynn here at our State of the City event. Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you. Well, I think the Lieutenant Governor did such an excellent job. There's very little left really to say about Bill Carpenter and about this great city of Brockton. Some of you may not know of my relationship, and a long-standing relationship with the city of Brockton goes way, way back for many years. I was the head baseball coach and basketball coach over here at Stonehill College. And we used to play our basketball games, in fact, at West Junior High School. And we had a lot of kids from this area, from this great city, that attended Stonehill College. And I was a great admirer of the athletic programs that you had here in Brockton. I might add that personal hero of mine, two of them actually, one was Ted Williams and the other one was Rocky Marciano. So you can see how the affection that I had for this great city, the city of champions. But I also have developed a relationship with other people over the years here in Brockton, Mark Lawton, and a whole series of people. But Bill Carpenter is somebody that I watched very, very closely, being a former mayor myself, president of the United States Conference of Mayors. I always thought that that was the most important job, most responsible job in politics in America, running a city. So much glare and fanfare goes into some of the other positions that politicians hold, but being mayor is somebody is always has to be out there on the front lines, listening to the people in good times, in bad times as well. And when I heard about Bill Carpenter running for mayor, I got to take a keen interest in him, and I was especially interested in, you saw some of it up here, and the issue of drugs and crime. Those are the real, if you're not, people aren't safe in their neighborhoods, then nothing else works. And Bill Carpenter was totally committed to that, and that was his highest priority. And when I heard that Bobby Hayden, who was my superintendent in Boston, and was one of the best appointments I ever made, is having Bobby Hayden, because he did for Boston what he did for you in Brockton. He went into the tough areas, the areas that, when I say tough areas, I don't mean tough from the standpoint of people. I mean from the standpoint of some of the problems, the social and economic problems, drugs and homelessness and so forth. And with Billy Carpenter by his side, he gave Bobby the leverage to do the job that had to be done. And I guess when he became commissioner, when he became the chief of police, I said to Bill Carpenter, I said, you're gonna find something that's hard to measure. He is going to have such a positive impact on the police because that's what he always considered himself. If you gave Bobby a job as, offered him a job as the United States ambassador to the UN, he wouldn't take it. What was he? He was a superintendent in Boston. Then he was the police commissioner up in Lawrence. Then he came down here in Brockton, put his heart and soul into it. You know, I'll tell you the one thing that I really admired about Bobby Hayden, and Billy Carpenter saw it. Bobby would leave the police station, go out into the neighborhoods, and talk to the drug dealers, talk to drug addicts. He'd talk to people down on their luck. He'd talk to homeless people who go into public housing. He'd get those people to understand that not only will they be prosecuted if they continue any kind of serious criminal situations, but he will also, he's their friend if they need one. And I think that's what he instilled in so many places that he went. My friends, tonight I'm here because of Billy Carpenter, because I think he's a fantastic mayor. I think he's done an extremely good job under the circumstances, trying to bring hope and jobs and opportunity. And I'm pleased to hear Karen Polito and Charlie Baker, because oftentimes cities don't get the support of the executives at the State House. But this is what is unique about Carpenter. Carpenter knows that you can't do this job alone. You have to bring in people at the highest level, even people of different parties, and that's what Billy Carpenter has done. My friends, I'm proud to be here tonight. I'm proud to call Bill Carpenter a friend, but I'm also proud as a former mayor in this great state of Massachusetts to see a man who follows in the tradition of commitment, compassion, and help for people down on their luck. And that's what we have here, that's what you have here in Brockton. It is my pleasure, and you know him far better than I do, but I just want you to know that he is a special mayor, somebody that we can all be proud of, from Brockton all the way up to Boston and places north, south, east, or west. He's an exceptional man, exceptional mayor, exceptional public servant, and I'm proud to call him my friend and introduce the mayor of Brockton, Mayor Bill Carpenter. Mayor?
Well, thank you. Well, first of all, Lieutenant Governor Polito, thank you for being here tonight, making the long trip to Brockton on a Friday evening. I think it shows the Lieutenant Governor's commitment to the cities and towns here in the Commonwealth that she's here with us tonight. And Ambassador Flynn, thank you for the great invitation again. I really appreciate Ambassador Flynn being here because he's filling in for Congressman Steve Lynch, who got stuck in D.C. today, who was filling in for Marty Walsh, who had a conflict and couldn't make it. So I was starting to take it a little personally that no one wanted to introduce me. But it all worked out. Tonight I also remember my friend and our retired police chief, Bob Hayden. And I hope the video gave you some idea of the impact that Chief Hayden had in this city in his 1 year with us. And tonight, sitting in the chief's seat, is his son, Bob Hayden, Jr. Bob, to acknowledge you. Thank you, Bobby. I know it means a lot to your father and to me that you're here. Well, good evening. Mr. Ambassador, Lieutenant Governor, city officials, members of the City Council and School Committee, our legislative delegation, ladies and gentlemen. Just over 3 years ago, we embarked on an ambitious three-point plan for Brockton's future, to restructure the operation of city government, to revitalize our city's economy, and to rebuild clean and safe neighborhoods. I'm proud to report that today we can see the results of those ongoing efforts. Today, our city government is more diverse, more accountable, and more user-friendly than ever. Our economic development strategies are paying dividends as we are creating jobs, attracting new and expanding investments, and for the first time ever, we have a comprehensive action plan for the revitalization of our downtown. Our neighborhoods, like our city, are on the way back. We're investing in our infrastructure, reclaiming and rebuilding the green spaces, and making our neighborhoods safer by getting the guns and drugs off the streets. The most important asset that our city government has is the people who work for it. When I first ran for mayor 4 years ago, I promised to open the doors of City Hall to everyone, and that's exactly what we've done. Our record speaks for itself. Excluding police and fire civil service hires, of the 106 new city employees hired by our administration, nearly half, 46%, are from our city's minority communities. Since taking office, I've made 101 appointments to city boards and commissions. Of those, more than half, 56%, come from our city's minority communities. Since day one of this administration, we have worked to fulfill our promise to make city government more diverse and reflective of the community it serves. To that goal, we reinstated the city's Diversity Commission. We've hired the first African-American female department head in the city's history. We also appointed the first minority-majority class of new police officers ever. I'm equally proud to say that Darren Duarte, my chief of staff, is the first person of color to serve in that role in our city's history. These firsts were long overdue. But despite the progress of the past 3 years, the integrity of the city's hiring practices have been brought back into question by the civil lawsuit brought by Mr. John Lopes, in which the jury found that in 2010, the city of Brockton engaged in discriminatory hiring practices against Mr. Lopes, and that in 2011, the city retaliated against Mr. Lopes for publicly complaining about that discrimination. Let's be clear. I was not the mayor in 2010. The mayor was Linda Balzotti. Nor was I the mayor in 2011. That was still Linda Balzotti. However, I am the mayor now, at the time of this jury's findings. And I do believe it is incumbent upon me to respond in a manner that assures the public that the city does not, has not, and will not engage in discriminatory hiring practices on my watch. Tonight, I'm announcing two independent reviews of the issues identified in the Lopes lawsuit. First, the city has retained the Edward J. Collins Jr. Center for Public Management at UMass Boston to conduct a complete analysis of the city's personnel department. The Collins Center consults with over 100 Massachusetts cities and towns to improve the operation of local government by instituting best practices. All current policies, procedures, and practices will be reviewed, including discrimination prevention and diversity. And following that review, the Collins Center will prepare a report with its findings, including recommendations. UMass Boston Chief Diversity Officer Georgiana Melendez will be a member of that Collins Center team. And in fact, the Collins Center team has already made an initial recommendation that the city implement diversity training offered by the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination. We are in contact with MCAD and are adopting this recommendation immediately. Secondly, we have retained former federal prosecutor Walter Prince to review the findings of the jury with respect to retaliation. In addition to his experience as a prosecutor, Attorney Prince has litigated more than 60 employment cases for some of the state's largest employers. Walter has advised both Senators Kerry and Warren on federal judicial nominations and is a former past president of the Massachusetts Black Lawyers Association. Not only will Attorney Prince review the conduct of city employees identified in the Lopes lawsuit, but he will also determine if any other city departments or employees have engaged in this type of misconduct. Attorney Prince will make specific findings and recommendations to ensure that residents are not subjected to retaliation or threats of retaliation, and he will also assist in the review of the Collins Center report. While we've made historic gains in the area of diversity over the past 3 years, we acknowledge that there is still much more work to do. We are fully committed to Brockton being not only a city of opportunity, but a city of equal opportunity. During the first 3 years of our administration, automating the functions of city government in order to become more accessible, more efficient, and more accountable has been a top priority. We have just recently gone live with a new online bill pay capability that allows residents to now pay their real estate taxes, excise taxes, water and sewer bills all online. This easy-to-use system enables residents to pay these bills conveniently and for just one penny more than the cost of a postage stamp. As you might remember, prior to our arrival, there were many shortcomings in the city's ability to issue accurate water bills. while with residents frequently questioning the water usage reported on their bill. Next week, the city will roll out the AquaHawk Alerting Customer Portal, a service that allows our water and sewer customers the ability to monitor their own water consumption in real time, receive timely leak alerts, and even customize alert settings simply by logging on to the DPW webpage. We've dramatically reduced the amount of payroll and purchase order paperwork by implementing GoDocs and installed a fully automated self-serve system at the city fuel pumps. Accountability is now improved with a recorded customer service telephone system in City Hall, while our DPW has adopted GPS technology for our outside contractors, and soon we will begin installing GPS into city vehicles. C-Click Fix grows in popularity daily. Accessed either online or through a smartphone app, C-Click Fix allows residents to report problems to a variety of city agencies 24/7 with no visitor phone call to City Hall necessary. City departments report back to constituents via email when their report is received and again when their problem is resolved. Despite the efficiencies that we've adopted, the cost of running city government increases each year, and at a rate much faster than increases in state local aid upon which Brockton relies. The result is an annual structural budget deficit in excess of $10 million. Looking forward to the upcoming fiscal year 18 budget, the forecast is bleak. Our Brockton public schools, however, continue to excel, offering opportunities to every child who lives in this city. Over the past 3 years, we've seen Brockton High School become a level one school, joining our two level one middle schools. Just last week, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education announced that Brockton High School has cut its dropout rate in half over the last 5 years. As we continue to invest in alternative pathways like our new Edison Academy, an afternoon and evening program where we have graduated over 200 students in our first 3 years. Recently, we partnered with Sprint to help close the digital divide by distributing 500 free wireless devices to Brockton High School students. 62 Brockton High School students were inducted into the National Honor Society this year, while 307 students were awarded John and Abigail Adams scholarships. In year two of our new sewerage agreement with Stonehill College, five more graduating Brockton students will receive $30,000 scholarships to Stonehill College this year. Sewerage for scholarships. Who says we don't think outside the box? And just a few months ago, in a true public-private partnership with the 3M Company and Boston Scientific, we reopened a new state-of-the-art planetarium at Brockton High School. I believe that Brockton is the best urban public school system in the state. And if you don't believe me, just look at those members of the Brockton High JROTC tonight. Were they impressive or what? However, our public school system, as we know it, is in jeopardy due to changes in how the state provides local aid to education. Out of over 300 school districts statewide, Brockton has the fourth lowest rate of increase in Chapter 70 funding this year. 0.2%. That's 0.002. An increase of only $300,000 in a $170 million budget. For the second consecutive year, we are essentially level funded for education, while the cost to run our schools increase about $10 million per year. At the same time, we continue to be one of the fastest growing school districts in the state, with a net gain of 214 students this year. That's up 1.2% from a year ago. That increase in enrollment alone, with no other changes, should have generated a $2.5 million increase in our school funding, yet we're level funded. How can that be? There are two primary reasons. A change made last year by the State Department of Elementary and Secondary Education in the formula to calculate the percentage of low-income students into what is now defined as economically disadvantaged. Prior to last year, this percentage was determined by our percentage of students receiving free or reduced lunch. For Brockton 2 years ago, that was 81%. Now, economically disadvantaged aid is received only if a member of the household can be identified as receiving state welfare assistance. Under this new process, only 53% of our students are identified as economically disadvantaged. 81% to 53%. Now, all of those students are still here. I'm pretty sure they're still low income. The state just changed the formula, reducing the Chapter 70 aid to Brockton by $6 million. That's right, based upon an administrative change in formula, Brockton school children lose $6 million. Brockton also takes a major hit this year on charter school tuitions. Brockton's cost for charter school tuitions increased by more than $5 million. In fact, this year, over $12 million of our local school dollars will never get here, redirected by the state to charter schools. Here, in a city where only 37% of the voters supported the expansion of charter schools, we are losing $12 million of local school money. Now, I'm not against charter schools, and I'm not against parents having choices. I'm against paying for it on the backs of poor urban gateway school systems like Brockton. It's wrong, it's unfair, it's discriminatory, and it needs to be changed. This year, the loss in funding of $11 million in state aid for the Brockton Public Schools will be devastating. And while a few hundred students move on to a charter school, the 17,000 Brockton Public School students left behind will pay for it. And the families in Wellesley and Newton won't feel a thing. We stand ready to work with our legislative delegation and the administration to create a more equitable formula. We must do this because the city lacks the financial resources to make up for the state. On the city side of the ledger, we've been hit by a 25% increase in pension costs this year, a $4.7 million annual increase in our assessment by the Brockton Retirement Board. This increase reflects higher projected retirement benefits due to salary increases over the past 6 years, coupled with investment returns on the pension fund that have been far below projections. This is an immediate $5 million budget deficit before we even begin to balance the budget this year. Fortunately, with the help of our unions, we've been able to control health insurance costs this year. The PEC, representing all retirees in school and city unions on the single issue of health insurance, recently agreed to plan design changes that will save the city about $1.5 million on health insurance costs. Despite these savings, the cost of health insurance this year still increases by about $750,000, or 1.5%. But even so, this compares well with the market rate increase of about 7%. Our annual budget shortfalls remind us how critical it is for the city to constantly seek to develop additional revenue streams. The tax title property auction program, launched during our first year in 2014, has been an ongoing success. Surplus properties acquired by the city from unpaid tax foreclosures are auctioned by a real estate custodian at no cost to the city. These are long-term vacant and abandoned properties that have been non-producing assets for years. To date, the city has received $2.3 million in additional revenue, with our next auction scheduled for April 27th. These properties not only go back on the tax rolls generating future revenue, but at a significantly higher assessed value after the new owner improves the property. Through this program, we are stabilizing neighborhoods and expanding the tax base while generating much needed cash for the city. Recently, with the support of the City Council, for the first time we established a citywide grants coordinator, Paul Yamano. Paul is now providing research and technical assistance to city departments and agencies so that we can identify and more effectively apply for grants. A key strategy of the grants coordinator is to serve as a matchmaker, if you will, between various public and private sector organizations to form collaborations for mutual grant opportunities, resulting in additional grant funding flowing into the city. And although the city desperately needs revenues, we must also ensure that we are assisting our senior citizens living on fixed incomes to be able to remain in their own homes. Next week, we will file legislation with the City Council that will increase two different property tax breaks for senior citizens while also making it easier for them to qualify. The 17D exemption, currently $175, will be increased to $250 while increasing the asset limit by 20%, allowing more seniors to qualify. We will also make it much easier to qualify for the 41C exemption that, if approved by the City Council, will increase from $500 to $750. We will roll back the eligibility age from 70 to 65, while increasing both the income and asset limits so that more of our seniors can take advantage of this tax break. In terms of the city's cost to provide water to our residents, there's good news. The city has entered into a tentative agreement to purchase the Aquaria Desal Water Plant. We have been able to negotiate a purchase price of $78 million. Conservatively, buying the plant with 20-year bond financing, that will save us about $1.5 million per year from our current obligation to Aquaria. In a stressed water budget, these savings will allow us to stabilize water rates and begin rebuilding our crumbling water main system. Brockton will be able to generate additional income by selling water to other communities. This asset purchase agreement requires Aquaria to complete several repair projects, including upgrades to the pipeline, replacing the membranes, and upgrading the raw water intake. It is far more favorable for the city to own the asset, building equity, and controlling the city's future water resource. We are now obtaining the plant at a reduced price that is even more favorable due to the required improvements by Aquaria. We look forward to filing this purchase agreement with the Water Commission next week, and upon their approval, it will then be filed for ratification with the City Council. This is a good deal that makes sense for the city. Creating jobs and spurring investment in Brockton has been a primary focus of this administration since the day we took office. We've built a team of economic development professionals led by our Director of Planning and Economic Development, Rob May, our Main Street Manager, Gary Leonard, and Robert Jenkins, the Executive Director of the Brockton Redevelopment Authority. We've continued to develop strategic partnerships with the Metro South Chamber of Commerce, the Brockton 21st Century Corporation, the Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board, Brockton Area Transit, and the Old Colony Planning Council, while also tapping into the resources of our educational partners, Bridgewater State University, Stonehill College, UMass Boston, Massasoit Community College, in addition to our local high school and regional VOTEC schools. Bridgewater State University President Fred Clark, who is here with us today. Fred, thank you for your leadership on the Skills Gap Connection, convening stakeholders, and for your engagement in the betterment of the City of Brockton and its entire region. Thank you. We're excited about the development of a private sector-driven Brockton partnership modeled after successful initiatives in Lawrence and Lowell. These are proven models that have taken these cities from the brink to flourishing gateway cities. This past year, we've worked extensively with all of the city's stakeholders in developing the blueprint for Brockton, a citywide comprehensive plan that will create a 30-year blueprint for the city's business districts and neighborhoods. This past year, the City Council has approved several pieces of important legislation that lay the groundwork for the revitalization of our downtown. The Downtown Action Strategy, the Urban Revitalization Plan that gives us the ability to cause the development of catalytic projects, projects that spur other projects. The Housing Development Program Incentive Plan that provides state tax incentives to private developers to build market-rate housing only in gateway cities. And the District Improvement Financing Plan, allowing incremental property tax growth within the downtown to be reinvested in the downtown. Growth pays for growth. We are uniquely positioned for transit-oriented, mixed-use development in our downtown that combines a vibrant business district with market-rate and workforce housing, with the incentives and programs now in place to make the numbers work for private investors. Retail follows rooftops. If we bring residents with disposable income downtown, the businesses will follow. We've worked closely with the Baker-Polito administration, our state legislative delegation, and state agencies including MassWorks, MassDOT, and the Executive Office of Housing and Economic Development to secure major state investments in city infrastructure that will support future economic development, leveraging public investment to attract private dollars. You can see those investments happening now. By the end of the month, we'll see the Plymouth County District Attorney's Office moving into the new headquarters in the heart of the downtown, bringing 25 state troopers with them to work every day. Not only removing and occupying a longtime vacant building, but changing the perception of public safety downtown. This critical piece of the downtown puzzle was only made possible by a $2.1 million appropriation by Governor Baker in the supplemental budget that made it through the House and Senate budget process due to the hard work of our state legislative delegation. This spring, we'll see us break ground on the reconstruction of Center Street between Main and Montello Streets downtown, along with the completion of the West Elm Street reconstruction and phase two of the Belmont Street project. Recently, the Lieutenant Governor came to Brockton to announce the largest investment to date, a $10 million MassWorks grant to fund the construction of a new downtown parking garage on Petronelli Way. The second largest MassWorks grant in the entire state this year. This is the transformative investment that will change the face of downtown Brockton. The construction of this garage will unlock several vacant and empty parcels for redevelopment, including 19 Main Street and the Petronelli Building, enable the development of 111 units of housing with Trinity Phase 2, and allow for further expansion by our two largest downtown employers, the Neighborhood Health Center and W.B. Mason. This north end of the downtown is ripe for redevelopment if only we build the parking. The garage construction includes the creation of a side street crossing the Petronelli Way and Franklin Streets that improves the traffic flow and returns Petronelli Way to two-way traffic, a first step towards restoring two-way traffic to Main Street. Now let me go over the numbers for you. The construction cost of the proposed garage is $12.5 million. It will be paid for by the $10 million grant from the state, a $500,000 contribution from Trinity Financial, and $2 million from the city that would be financed by a bond. The city's annual payment on the $2 million note will be no more than $160,000 per year. Once completed, the garage will be turned over to the Brockton Parking Authority. We get a brand new parking garage at 20 cents on the dollar. But wait, the deal gets a little better. Once the garage is built, Trinity immediately goes forward with the construction of phase two. The additional property tax revenue generated by Trinity phase two alone will be $195,000 per year, $35,000 more per year than our share of the cost of the garage. And that's not even counting the parking revenue that will be generated to the parking authority. Folks, folks, at the end of the day, this new $12.5 million garage comes at no cost to the taxpayers. On April 3rd, we will file the $2 million borrowing request with the City Council. I urge the councilors to approve this borrowing so that this critical project that pays for itself can go forward. The numbers work all day long. Ladies and gentlemen, we are creating jobs and we are attracting investment to Brockton. In January of 2014, when we took office, Brockton area unemployment stood at 9.1%. 3 years later, in January of 2017, our unemployment rate is down to 4.4%. That's less than half of where it stood 3 years ago. We've identified food processing, healthcare, and advanced manufacturing as growth industries for Brockton in the next decade. Just 2 days ago, the Massachusetts Office of Business Development announced an economic development incentive program investment tax credit for Evans Machine Company for the second expansion of their advanced manufacturing facility on North Manchester Street. While the upcoming year will see the redevelopment of the LeBaron Foundry site by the D.W. Clark Company, a $6 million private investment that will convert a polluted, abandoned 5.5-acre site into an advanced manufacturing facility, bringing 50 jobs to the city and creating an additional 25 more. At the same time, over the past 2 years, we've seen record investment in the city of Brockton. New growth in fiscal year 2016 was $2.9 million, followed by an additional $2.2 million in new growth in fiscal 2017. This is the largest two-year period of new growth in Brockton since growth figures began being recorded in 1984. We are building a new Brockton, and the numbers show it. Every day we work to restore safe and clean neighborhoods to our city. Neighborhoods where families want to buy their own home and raise their children. We're reclaiming ownership of our parks, playgrounds, and green spaces. We reopened a newly renovated James Edgar Playground, resurrected an abandoned neighborhood playground on Mulberry Street, replaced an old City Hall Plaza with an inner city park. And this spring, we'll dedicate the new Charlie Tartaglia Park, creating neighborhood green space on the site of a former brownfield. And we're already underway on the renovation of Keith Park in Campello that will include the refurbishing of the historic fountain. And my thanks to the Keith Park Neighborhood Association for being our partner on that project. And we are already planning a $500,000 investment in Walker Playground that is funded by a combination of state park grant funds and CDBG federal grant money. During 2014, we began the restoration of the DW Field Golf Course, a beautiful track that had been allowed to deteriorate over a number of years. 3 years later, Brockton is now home to one of the finest municipal golf courses in the state. We've made year-round investments in the course, including the rebuilding of a fully functioning irrigation system, dramatically improved playing conditions from tee to green, reintroduced tournaments and leagues, and upgraded both the pro shop and food service operations. This year's projects currently underway include the restoration of 9 bunkers on 5 holes out on the course, and also include a new player lounge in the clubhouse. The course opens next Friday. If you haven't been to D-Dubs lately, come on out and play around. I guarantee that you'll be back. Our efforts to reduce our carbon footprint and become a green, sustainable city have been recognized by the state, as we have just been officially designated by the Department of Energy Resources as a green community. Earning that designation will bring Brockton over $500,000 of green community grant money this year to fund energy efficient projects. We're looking forward to the official announcement here in Brockton by state officials in the coming weeks. Lights and cameras. We know that when neighborhoods and business districts are well lit, with outside video surveillance cameras in place, they become safer. Green community status will make Brockton eligible for reimbursement of 30% of the cost of replacing every street light in the city with LED lighting this year. Two years of audit, design, and procurement will finally come to fruition this summer when we begin replacing the city's street lights with LED lighting. The new LED lights will not only shine 50% brighter, but will use less than half the electricity of the old lights. The LED lighting project is a major investment by the city to improve pedestrian and bicyclist safety, reduce crime, and conserve energy, reducing the city's electricity costs, all major initiatives of this administration. We anticipate that the city will be able to recoup more than half the estimated $3.3 million cost of the LED lights through the Green Communities Grant and National Grid incentives. That means that these LED lights will pay for themselves in 3 years or less through energy savings with lighting that comes with a 10-year warranty. This also means that we've become eligible for over $1 million of state grant money this year directly as a result of our designation as a green community. This year, we continue to build our network of outside video cameras by coordinating the resources of numerous city departments and agencies, including the Brockton Housing Authority, the Brockton Parking Authority, the Brockton Area Transit, Brockton Public Schools, DPW Refuse Department, and 21st Century Corporation, along with our police and fire departments. This strategic coordination of resources has allowed us to build a citywide network of over 170 public cameras, with a goal to get to 250 by the end of this year. Now, we need your help in expanding this network by registering privately owned outside cameras viewing public areas with the Brockton Police Department. It only takes a few minutes to register your cameras online at either the Brockton City or Police Department websites. The data will be stored in a secure database, and then using our new GPS mapping technology, detectives will be able to identify camera locations with contact information in the vicinity of a crime scene within minutes, instead of hours of canvassing an area to try to find cameras. Today, the single largest threat to the quality of life for Brockton residents is the opioid addiction epidemic. Just think for a minute about the challenges faced by cities like Brockton today. Homelessness, property crime, gun violence, street-level drug dealing, prostitution. What is the common denominator? Drug addiction. The personal cost in lives wasted, lives lost, and the impacts on the families and loved ones of individuals struggling with addiction are hard to quantify, but they are real, and they hurt. Just ask a child, or a sibling, or a parent, like my friend George Fisk. George lost his son Lance to an overdose back in 2009, just days before I was to announce my first run ever for public office, Ward 5 School Committee. I couldn't believe it when George walked into my announcement speech on the night before his son Lance's funeral. I was recently reminded about a promise that I made to George during my remarks that night. And it wasn't just another empty promise from a mayor. 8 years ago, it was simply a promise from one dad to another. That night I said, "We're going to keep talking about guns and drugs and gangs until our young people stop dying in this city. That's a promise I will keep." And George, that's a promise I'll continue to keep. And just like he was 8 years ago, George is here tonight. And George represents a lot of parents who have lost their children in this deadly epidemic. George, please let everyone know where you're sitting there. George. There is some reason for hope. The monthly number of fire and police department responses to overdose calls has trended down somewhat recently, from an average of 90 per month in 2015, dropping to an average of 71 per month during the second half of 2016. For the first time in several years, the number of overdose deaths in Brockton went down as well. In fact, nearly a 15% decrease from an all-time high of 123 deaths in 2015 to 105 in 2016. But just as we begin to feel that we may be turning the corner on this crisis, cheap, deadly fentanyl arrives and brings a whole new wave of fatalities with it. We do know that the Champion Plan is saving lives. Earlier, you saw firsthand the incredible work being done by our Champion Plan partners and volunteers. In our first year, over 400 admissions to treatment, all to individuals who walked into the Brockton Police Department seeking help. The Champion Plan is changing the perceptions of both police officers and those who are suffering. Brockton is leading the way with our compassionate approach to this public health crisis. But make no mistake, we are just as committed to interrupting the supply of this poison to the streets of our city. Soon after taking office in January of 2014, we pledged an aggressive, relentless pursuit of every drug dealer in the city, and that pursuit continues harder than ever today. In 2013, I should probably say back in 2013, the Brockton Police Department served 38 search and entry warrants, drug raids. This past year, in 2016, Brockton Police served 79 search warrants, more than double the number of raids than the year before we arrived. Just this morning, Brockton Police executed a search warrant at a home that has been a source of many neighborhood complaints. Massachusetts State Police detectives and U.S. Marshals joined Brockton Police detectives entering the property, and as a result, four people were arrested on warrants, and seven others were arrested on drug charges. Crack cocaine, heroin, and other drugs were seized. Each one of these 79 warrants, just like this morning's, represents a costly and time-consuming investigation. That police overtime comes at a cost. It's a cost that we must be willing to pay. Not only are these raids getting drugs off our streets, but they're also part of an overall strategy to get the illegal guns out of our city. Because we know that today, illegal guns and drugs are tied together. So while the governor of New Hampshire may want to blame Lawrence for the drugs in his state, maybe he should pay some more attention to the steady flow of illegal handguns from New Hampshire to the streets of Brockton. We need regional and federal strategies to stop both gun and drug trafficking. We must also continue to invest in the best technology available to support the police officers out on the front lines. Just over a year ago, we deployed the latest gunshot detection technology over a 5-square-mile area of the city. ShotSpotter immediately alerts our police officers to the exact location of a shots fired incident, allowing our officers to respond while witnesses and evidence are still there. In 2016, Brockton ShotSpotter system detected gunfire that directly led to the arrests of 7 individuals. And in each case, either guns or drugs were located at the scene, and charges were filed ranging from attempted murder to armed assault. 2016 also saw the Brockton Police Department hire its first crime analyst. The crime analyst now provides a daily intelligence briefing that updates all of our officers with critical, up-to-date information, such as persons of interest and hotspots identified by analyzing recent crime data. Strategies first introduced by Chief Hayden and now implemented under the leadership of Chief Crowley are working. We've created the Mobile Operations Unit, our police motorcycles, and reinstated the bicycle patrol officers. Our motorcycle and bicycle patrols are proactively targeting street-level quality-of-life crimes. We continue to expand real community policing efforts at a time when our immigrant communities fear the threats they hear coming out of Washington. It is not my job as mayor to enforce federal immigration laws. My job is to protect the residents of this city. Gangs, guns, and drugs. If you're involved in illegal gang activity or drug dealing, it is our responsibility to remove you from this community using any and all means available. If you're not engaged in gangs, guns, or drug dealing, then you have nothing to fear. We are continuously engaged in multi-level, multi-jurisdictional investigations, partnering with county, state, and federal law enforcement agencies, pooling resources and intelligence to identify targets of mutual interest. We also continue to target repeat violent offenders because we know that a large percentage of violent crime is committed by a very small percentage of the population. Our gang and narcotics detectives, now with the support of the crime analyst, maintain a list of the most dangerous repeat violent offenders. And every time that we get one of these people off the street, the city is a safer place. The numbers show that these investments and strategies are working. Occurrences of firearm-related incidents are down 27% over the last 3 years. And last year, there were only 2 homicides. The last time that Brockton saw less than 2 homicides in a year was 35 years ago. While the numbers may fluctuate, there is no question that there is less gun violence in Brockton today than there was 3 years ago. While we're investing in technology, utilizing data, and implementing effective crime-fighting strategies, nothing is more important than getting more boots on the ground. That is why tonight I am pleased to announce the hiring of 15 new police officers, and we have already begun the civil service hiring process. We've already begun the civil service hiring process that will allow us to select 4 of these 15 new officers from special bilingual hiring list. We are committed to building a diversified community police force that more accurately reflects and represents the community that it serves. When I was first sworn in as mayor in January of 2014, Brockton had 176 officers. This summer, when our newest officers enter the police academy, it will bring our total staffing to 200 police officers. The largest number of Brockton police officers that we have had on the job since 1987, and an increase of 24 additional police officers in just the past 3 years. Today, Brockton is poised for resurgence as a model 21st century city. We are creating jobs, attracting and revitalizing a walkable downtown while restoring our neighborhoods. To my friends and colleagues on the City Council, it's time to put partisan politics, To my friends and colleagues on the City Council, it's time to put partisan politics and obstructionary tactics aside and work together to build a new Brockton. I'm reminded of an old quote. I'm reminded of an old quote from former United States Speaker of the House Sam Rayburn. This quote was always a favorite of Tip O'Neill's. Rayburn said, "Any jackass can kick down a barn, but it takes a carpenter to build one." Let's build it together. Let's build it together. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not just building a city. We're building a future for the next generation of Brocktonians. Senator Edward Kennedy once said, "America is a nation founded on hope and the constant quest for a better tomorrow. We know the future will outlast all of us." He continued, "But I believe we all live on in the future that we make." I can't think of two people who better illustrate Senator Kennedy's statement than Dan and Angela Henry. They have responded to the tragic death of their son by creating the DJ Dream Fund. And through the work of the DJ Dream Fund, they are ensuring that all Brockton children enjoy the same opportunities. And Dan and Angela, I do believe, as Senator Kennedy said, that DJ lives on in the future that they are making for these young people. Are Dan and Angela here? Dan and Angela here? I'm so sure. I thought I saw them earlier. There. Oh, there. Up in the balcony. You would have thought they could have got a better seat. They know the mayor, for Pete's sakes. Jeez. Brockton is a tough, resilient city. Just like our great heavyweight champion, Rocky Marciano, we've been knocked down a couple of times. But like the champ, we always get back up. That's who we are. Brockton is coming back. Make no mistake about it. But we can only make this comeback together. As my friend Pastor Orlando Harris says, we are better together. It's time to stop seeing Brockton as old Brockton and new Brockton. We will never achieve greatness divided. Diversity is our strength. Forget about old Brockton, forget about new Brockton. It's time for one Brockton. One team, one fight, one Brockton. That's my dream and my vision for the future of this city. One team, one fight, one Brockton. Thank you for being here. Good night.